I'm Frederica Holloway, also known as Freddie Me Asha, and I'm excited to have a special guest, a very special guest I haven't seen in the flesh in so long, but I'm always just so happy to see him and just uber excited. My brother from another mother, Jaytoo, Jamal Jeffries.
What's going on?
I've seen you, Mama Love. How are you doing?
I'm all right. I seen you about, it was a little over a year ago. That don't seem like that long no more. That don't seem like that long no more. I'm all right. I am gonna have to step out, but we're not there yet. I didn't bring any white. I need some white paint. But I'll get it together.
That's funny you say that. I need some white paint too. I was trying to do something and I needed some white. Well, actually, I have white paint. I needed some white spray paint.
Yeah. No, I got white spray paint. I'm using some different stuff today, so I gotta find some white paint in a few. But I don't need it right this second.
Have white spray paint. No, and I have white paint. So we need to do a swap, like in person.
All right, sure. Sure.
Well, thank you for joining us on Creative Circle. How have you been? How are you holding up in all this craziness?
Day to day. I'd be lying to say if it was all good or all bad. You know, it's like most other times, just with a little extra seasoning on it. Not like the seasoning I really like it's like too much mayo or like too much Lowry seasoned salt. You know what I mean? It's just something an objectionable taste. But still, I push on. So, you know, it's cool. It's Sunday. I'm gonna probably take a nap after we done. So
that's what Sundays are for—rest and relaxation, right?
Yeah, I didn't really get a lot of rest earlier, just because I did a thing last night, and I got a late start, so. Yeah.
Tell us, what'd you do last night?
So for anybody who doesn't know, you know, I DJ a little bit. And so, yeah, just a little bit. Definitely one of the places that was open in Chicago the longest, on kind of some underground stuff was this spot, Danny's. Danny's was in like Bucktown. So it's like on Dickens, which is like kind of around Armitage and right off of Damon. But they had been open for like 30 years or something, and they shut down due to COVID-19. And we did a live stream kind of tribute of, you know, in honor of the spot. I had a residency there. Basically up until the very end. So the last time I played at Danny's was in March, like around March 11th or something like that. And then the world turned upside down and they never recovered. So, you know, it wasn't a glitzy place, but it was a fun place. It was very fun. And I fell down the stairs in there one time. Yeah, it was a short set of stairs too, but you could really mess yourself up. I think I fell twice in the same trip.
Oh, wow.
Like I hit the floor, I bounced up, and then I fell down again. And I was holding a record in my hand. So I saved a record, but I had a mild contusion.
I was just going to ask, did you save the record? Did you save the album?
That was why I fell twice, because I was holding the record up so I didn't fall on the record.
Oh, that is so funny.
Yeah, yeah. So that's what I did yesterday.
Wait, so you were holding one record, not a crate, because you know we done toured and done some stuff, and we done carried equipment and crates. So you were carrying how much?
One record.
One record, and you fell.
Well, they got some tricky stairs in there, and it's just, I've seen a lot of people take spills off the bottom step. It's just, it's tricky, and if you know about it, then chances, if you've been there more than three times, you might have tripped on them boys too, so.
That's true, and you know, if it's an evening place where you done got some sweat and some libations, you know, it don't even have to be tricky stairs. You could just, you know, have had a little good time.
No, I mean, I'm pretty good about being able to not fall down when I walk. So I would just blame it on the general darkness and the BS nature of the stairs. So I'm not going to blame it on the alcohol.
Okay. Well, we're going to blame it on the architecture and interior design of the stairs. We're going to talk to our friends about that. Well, thank you for joining me. We definitely want to have a good time tonight. So for those of you guys, if this is new to you, Creative Circles is a space where I invite different guests that are artists and with multiple mediums. It doesn't, you know, I don't discriminate different mediums, and we get on and talk to them, get to introduce you to them. And then on top of that, you get to actually see us create some pieces while we actually talk and dialogue. So I wanted to invite my brother, Jamal Jeffries, AKA the DJ, djyomamaluv, we affectionately call Jaytoo, who I know from having toured and worked with Prime Meridian, and he's been a DJ for years, and they're a DJ for years. And at the same time, we've worked together with youth in the capacity of visual arts, and he's designed and taught classes around painting and art and graffiti arts. So wanted to have him join us so that he can share a little bit about that, share about what he's doing. And he sketches, he draws, he paints, he spray paints. And I'm actually incorporating a little bit of that today. So I'm actually gonna start off with first asking, what you gonna create with us today, Mr. Jaytoo?
All right, well, I'm space is kind of at a premium over here right now. And I had to figure out something that I would be able to present in a very small format. So I'm working on a small illustration. I don't know if you'd be able to see it, but it's just pencil, it's some loose sketch right now. And I'm going to render it with like some heavy permanent ink, and I'm using gouache. And gouache is like it's a water soluble paint. So it's not quite as it's like a step between watercolor and acrylic. So gouache is good for doing smaller pieces like this. So I'm using watercolor paper, because depending on you can get some Bristol paper or something, and when you wet the paper tends to buckle. And then what happens when the paper starts buckling is then you start making holes in the paper. So this stuff can handle multiple mediums. It's usually two types of paper that you can use. This is cold press. Normally I would use hot press, but they don't really make hot press in this size. And hot press is a lot more expensive. But hot press is a lot more flexible.
And what are you gonna do with this sketch? What are you gonna use it for?
I don't know. Ain't nothing in particular.
I'm just, I'm just happy to have you sketching with us, because if you don't mind sharing with the people, because I know you do album covers and murals. Can you share a few projects that you've done over the years?
Oh, wow. Shit. I've done a lot. I want to say one of the first kind of commission pieces I did ever in life was for a church program. So I had to be like in the seventh grade. So I did something. There was a handbook for something that was happening at the church. So I drew like the cover. I may even busted out a little calligraphy on them, because we was big into learning calligraphy at that time. So that was way back in like 1984, 85. So that was kind of, I mean, I've been drawing since I was a shorty. Since as long as I can remember, I've been drawing. So, but my old man and my mom's, they can both draw. So I think the gene was already there. But besides that, I did a solo art show a couple of years ago at the Silver Room. It was called I'll Never Grow Old. And people thought that, mistook that as like I didn't want to grow up. And I was like, it doesn't say I don't want to grow up. Growing old and growing up is two different things. So I grew up a long time ago, but I still like to keep a zesty, youthful lust for life. So I did that. That was a couple years ago. I make flyers and posters for the majority of my events before the pandemic jumped off. I usually would DJ, you know, on average, maybe three nights a week. So that's a lot of work that keeps me super busy. I recently worked on some album, not the full cover art, but like some auxiliary art for a record label called Black Pegasus, which is based out of Chicago. Not draw anything else. Besides that, I worked on the 606 Trail, the Bloomingdale Trail. I painted something over there when they opened it up. That was a few years ago. But besides that, yeah, a lot of stuff I do winds up being for stuff I put out. So,
you know, most of them know I'm a runner, and I don't think I have ran over by the 606. So now I'm about to go looking for it.
Yeah, I don't know if it's still over there. They might have painted over it at this point. They might have cleaned all that stuff off. But I mean, I got paid for it. So if they want to clean it off, I got pictures. I've yet to reveal publicly what my tag name is in regards to the graffiti thing, because I'm still somewhat active, semi-illegally, allegedly. So I can't really reveal that thing. I'm definitely looking to, you know, talk about it soon, just because, you know, time gets short, and I just feel like it would be an interesting story to be told, is because it was very influential doing the graffiti. Very.
That's great. I'll let you go ahead and get started with your project, and thank you for explaining that. I learned something myself, and I definitely want to check out the 606 just to see if it's still over there.
It was a bunch of stuff up there, but I feel like the area surrounding the Bloomingdale Trail is rapidly gentrifying. So, you know, them people, they like it when they don't live there and they want to move there. But once they move in there, they don't want to see none of that stuff. So That's how that goes.
No, I do know how that goes.
Yeah.
And just for the people who are watching, because I did have a few responses I put a call out. So I'm actually working on some pieces using some spray paint. So it's interesting that you say, you know, you're still active. So funny how spray paint is illegal or you can't buy it in the city. But then certain other weapons you can purchase, but I'm not going to go there right now. But in the suburbs,
hey, man, you know, art can be dangerous, but art is kind of soft right now. So, and it has been for a while. Everybody want to get rich. It's like rap.
Right. Right. So, yeah, I'm working on a few pieces. Actually, if you've been following, I did launch my website, Creations by FN, or Creations by Freddie Niasha, but the actual site is creationsbyfn.com. And these pieces that I'm wearing today are wooden triangles that I have posted for sale. I actually asked before we got started on social media, wanted to get some feedback from the audience beforehand to find out what two colors or three colors that people would like if they had to do two-tone jewelry. So that would inspire and I work with. So I actually had my friend and mother of my goddaughter, Marissa, she responded with black or red. So I'm actually making a set for her. And then my friend who's a running buddy, running family, Jamaica, she said two. She said purple and yellow or purple and gold and blue and gold. So I have done the gold, or as you can see, the spray paint, and I'm going to decide if I'm going to do the blue or the purple. If she's watching, feel free to put it in the comments, because I have to choose one. But I got the red and black going.
You ain't got no mask on. You in there? Are you in there sucking on them spray paint fumes?
Yeah.
Are you in there sucking on spray paint fumes? You better put a mask on.
I'm more concerned, worried about COVID than my spray paint, but I do have a window. I mean, I got ventilation.
Okay. I'm just saying.
I'm spray painting a lot. No. So usually when I spray paint, I'm outside. But when I am inside, I'm not doing it heavy, and I do have like my window ventilation.
I got some experience with that stuff, and it'll get you high if you're not careful. So.
I could attest to that. That's why I definitely, like, I don't go heavy. You see, the pieces are small, and this is, like, as much spray paint as you see. It's not a whole lot. So I'm going to be working on that today as we talk with Mr. Jaytoo. So you kind of told us a little bit. I did not know, and I met your dad, definitely. I did not know your parents both drew and sketched. So it is.
No, they definitely... Nah, they definitely are better than normal. My dad actually, he's been doing some painting over the last few years. He got some really interesting painting. I like his stuff a lot. It don't look nothing like mine. My stuff, I'm a little more graphic, kind of what's the word I'm thinking of? Graphic as in, I mean, I come up on comic books. So, you know, a lot of stuff still would take on some comic features, even though I mean, that's like one of those things I try to stay away from. Like I hate when one of the things, and I don't hate a lot of things. I hate very few things. But one of the things when I was teaching art was, I'm working with black kids almost exclusively, like 99.8% black. And it would dismay me a little bit because they really were leaning heavy on the on the anime kind of style of drawing. And I just didn't like it. I think it doesn't really work. It's fine for what it is, but it's just like, it's like kindergarten stuff to me, but not in a good way, because there's some kindergarten stuff that's cold, but this is like, I really had to fight with them to get out of that vein of, I don't know, it does something to your head when you start, if that's all you kind of like repeating and kind of like using for your references and stuff. You should use stuff that's kind of familiar. You know, it's nothing wrong with drawing Black people.
And if I could attest to, you know, your connection with young people, for the last time, well, a few times we've worked together at the Gary Coleman Youth Center, but then also I had a youth program or was doing a summer camp over on the west side, and it was all around graffiti arts and murals. And man, they love you.
Hey, that was like one of the best groups of kids I've ever worked with. I've never encountered a group like that. Cause they was really, really they was just about it, man. They was just really like, they was really gung-ho and really embraced it. You know, the behind the scenes stuff spoiled the program because it just turned into a mess. And I felt bad just because they really were, like, them kids were awesome. Them little kids was the stuff. You know what I mean? They definitely, they were the type of kids that volunteered help. They didn't wait for you to ask. They asked you.
And you know, especially with youth now and, you know, the whole thing around technology and all this stuff, Snapchat, TikTok, whatever, we talked for a minute about that. But the idea, you know, like things like woodworking, art, the utilization of things with your hands, it's almost like, you know, people look at it as like, yes, you want to go to school and be intelligent and use your mind, but your hands are extension of that to be able to create a lot of different things. And that, I feel, is one of the things that actually our young people, when you create an opportunity for them to get away from tech stuff and Twitter, or maybe not Twitter, but TikTok and all this stuff, they actually love being able to paint and make music and do things with their hands. It's like a whole nother realm that's open for them. And I think that's actually why your program and why you connect so well, because it's like, okay, put down the phone, you know, for an hour, and then they just kind of go at it. And their ideas are just fascinating when they're just not like plugged in. It's like take away, unplug from the matrix, and you see some of the best and just most fascinating things that our young people create.
No, it was dope. I mean, I haven't worked full time, you know, with the kids in about 4 years, but that is probably the only thing I missed, was the actual interaction. Just, you know, letting them breathe a little bit and let them talk and let them get some stuff out of their head. You know, a lot of times you would really have to, you know, you had to pride, you had to do quite a bit of prodding and poking. But in general, the ones you had to prod and poke would come out with some of the more interesting stuff. You know, it's just not really, I don't know if this is really the time to be unique for unique sake as opposed to unique for views. So to do it when it's in a vacuum is a different thing. It's cool to do goofy shit on TV or whatever, but when it's just y'all, you know, it's like, well, what's the payoff? And the payoff is that you get to make something. Nobody else in the universe can do what you just did. So that was, I was always very much into the idea of just ownership and being able to have things that you can say you did. And can't nobody ever really take that away from you. Even if they lie and say they did it, they still can't take it away from you, because you know, and they know that they lying.
Well, so, true. So tell us a little bit about what you've been working on lately and maybe what you got coming up for the new year.
Staying alive.
Yeah. I meant artistically.
That too, staying alive artistically. Right now, so I got maybe one, I have a broadcast that's coming up, just like some mixed thing on the music side. That's coming up Thursday the 22nd, on Worldwide FM. And that's some, I think it's an internet deal based out of the UK. And we did it with a guy who's also a DJ, but he's a promoter and kind of, you know, one of them dudes that will be moving and shaking. But me and Sean Dervis have a DJ team called, we the Big Fellas. So the big fellas thing is we do all 45s. Cut it out. We just play 45s. So it's all vinyl and it's all 45. So the difficulty level of DJing all 45s is through the roof. It's probably one of the hardest things you could do. So we did something. I did something for that. That's coming up. I'll be doing some kind of virtual New Year's Eve thing. So I'm waiting to hear. It's not gonna be live. It's not gonna be live. It's not. It's gonna be pre. It's not. It's gonna be pre-recorded. But I'm waiting on the details for that. Besides that, working on making some music. So during, you know, January, February, I'll probably get started on that. And then I also got a backlog of mixes and episodes I've recorded and then stuff from the radio shows I did. So all of that stuff needs to have covers. So I have to make a million covers. Hopefully by the spring, I'll be painting. And I'll be working on some other stuff like some merch, some t-shirts, and general other things adorned with little bits of my soul.
That's, man, your 2021 is about to be full. That's great.
So with the DJ stuff, it's like, I got time. There is no DJ stuff, really. So you go from, you know, working maybe three nights a week. And I mean, I've been on that schedule since about 1997. So we got to say that's on average. Because it could definitely be a week where you playing five or six times. But going from that kind of schedule to playing once a month, possibly. Yeah, I got time now. I got time.
Which actually leads me to my next question. And I've asked pretty much everybody who's been featured on Creative Circle this. We recognize being in a time of COVID and social distances. So, you know, we've kind of scaled it back. Being at home, not as active per se, like I said, for someone like yourself who's normally DJing at different events and stuff, you know, for a lot of artists, it can be seen as a very tough time different time in the sense of not being out there like that. However, can you share with us, like, what has been, I guess, in a sense, the good thing about this time period and, you know, outside of, you know, like I said, you know, a lot of us may not be making as much money or having the opportunities to be out there, but what has creating during this time been like for you?
I'll be honest, the benefits of it have been I actually got a little time to sit still and kind of get a little organized, because so much, you know, when it's popping, it's popping. So it's just, it's steady, steady moving. You know, it's like, it's a lot of moving parts, and it's constantly, you know, you're checking like 5 to 10 different things, because it's stuff filtering in from all over the place. So it's giving me a little time to catch my breath. You know, like I said, that schedule I've been keeping it, you know, for 20 something years, where it, you know, you work during the day and you do this type of stuff at night. So, you know, I'm dealing with about 20 years of sleep deprivation too. So I don't, I miss the interaction the most. I miss the money. I need money, but I don't miss it nearly as much as I miss, you know, me being a DJ is like the ultimate icebreaker. It gets me, it would get me in a lot of different kind of scenarios, and interesting things be happening. So you meet all kinds of interesting people. That's probably the biggest benefit, was just being able to take a step back and not having to rush so much all the time. So that's it. I think that would be it. Yeah, taking some time. Taking some time to sit back. You know, I wasn't looking at none of my stuff like, oh yeah, I'm cold-blooded or anything, but it definitely made me like want to do some, like I got more work to do, but now I can actually spend some time kind of plotting a bunch of stuff out. And I wasn't really having that much time before. So time is the benefit.
I definitely can relate and agree. You know, me having a 9-to-5 and doing a lot of creative things on the personal business side is can be challenging.
Yeah.
But being really, like you said, having time to really focus on that. I think if anything, and I try to use that as encouragement for a lot of other people who may have other gifts that's like you said, we're so busy, you know, now it's not running out to do this, running out to do that. Got this. I mean, physically, we got a lot of Zoom calls. I do, but being able to have time after work hours to create, to plan some things that normally you wouldn't have, because you're out of sight somewhere and you're running here, there, the other light. So it's just, I will say, I definitely appreciate the blessing of this time, is being able to be a little bit more still, to actually hone talents, gifts that unfortunately, when you're caught up in the busyness of life, it's hard to do. So I definitely could appreciate that. I do wonder, the question for you, you know, in the midst of all this, you know, with the elections, and, you know, I can't go without talking about what's been going on, current events.
All right, let's go for it.
Yeah, you know, I got to bring that up, especially, you know, Black folks, and we're dealing with a lot. And art often speaks to the times, right? For some people.
It should.
You know, and I will say, you know, feel free to share any thoughts that you may have on, you know, what you feel is an important message for you to get across, either in your art or things to be able to share or speak to at a time like this, when we're dealing with things like, you know, our elections, what's been going on as far as racial differences, social justice, different issues as far as, you know, the killing of Black men, and all, you know, there's a lot going on. Any thoughts on?
Yeah, it's a lot to unpack.
Say it again?
I said it's a lot to unpack.
It is, is, but you know, a lot of people, different issues resonate for them. So is there anything that you feel like in your art or in what you do, you feel passionate about, that you feel like you want to be able to represent in your art, or you feel just really resonates with you?
Well, I mean, for me, just to exist is kind of a political statement. So I feel like as long as I'm operating from, you know, from a certain standpoint, you know, I'm not a big talker. This is the most you've probably ever heard me talk, like in a long time, if ever. So this year, as turbulent as it has been, I think it's really been good because a lot of things have come to light. And it's things that, you know, I've encountered, you know, all my life. But now it's just like, you know, everybody sees it. But the thing is, so we was lying all the time. So I'm not really gonna give a lot of people a pass. I just don't, and I never will. You know what I mean? Because once you get to be a certain age, you're supposed to know better. And even if you don't, you should strive to know better. So either you're just, you know, wired, messed up, or you willfully choose to be the way that you are. So I'm not a fan of bullies in any form. So it's a lot of stuff that I don't really ride with, you know, and a lot of Black people might, you know what I mean? I'm no Trump supporter, but I will say this, that without him, as messed up as it is, would any of these things have happened? You know what I mean? So I'm not saying thank you to him, but I'm saying that everything serves a purpose. Jackass he may be, him doing what he's been doing, you know, is part of the catalyst for a lot of other things. But then I also get concerned because I know that when movements get to be a certain size and get a certain visibility, they tend to get co-opted. And it's a lot of agents and it's a lot of people who play like they down, but they not really down. So anybody who's listening, you take that however you want. But I'm just saying, I had some real early experiences with racism, you know, like early age. And I never understood it because it just never made sense to me. You know, if I have a problem with somebody, it's usually pretty personal. It ain't, you know, I don't like to just catch a bunch of people up in a big net and say y'all messed up and this, that, and the other. But, you know, I'm a man. They not. Ain't something else.
I definitely thank you for that because, you know, what you hit home on is everything happens for a reason. So yeah. As much as I cringe around some of the things that that Trump has done and said, you know, when Barack became president, people were like, yeah, racism is over. And see, everything's equal. You know, like we've made it. And
just beginning.
You know, in many ways, I was like, no, there's a lot of issues still going on. Just because we have a Black president doesn't mean it just went away. And so him being Trump, being president and saying and bringing to light a lot of things is like, see, I told you this hasn't gone anywhere. So if anything, the opportunity of this being brought to the light, I won't say is a good thing in a sense that it's like, yeah, it still exists and there's still work to be done. And I like to believe that no matter what you're doing, because that's the other thing is that I, you know, on Facebook, you know, people criticize each other for like this ain't gonna work. What's the point of protesting? The Ali's, and it's like, hold up. Everybody has a specific gift or talent. I don't care what it is, singing, speaking, a lawyer, art, or whatever. Whatever you can use your gift to speak to and speak power to and to create change, I'm all about that. So let's stop the divide and conquer. You know, if you know something that you feel passionate about really speaks to resonate, I mean, really resonates with you to actually speak to making a difference. I like to believe, like for me, working with our youth has been one of the things. It's like, hey, talking with them about what's going on. We recently were talking about some of the legislation around youth at the age of 16 being able to not one vote possibly, but also to be better educated by the time they're young adults, 18, to actually vote and learn about, you know, the candidates. I mean, that's something grown men and women don't do. It's like, how do you educate and know who your alderman is? Who are these judges? What are they doing? What are the decisions that they're making? Like, these are the kind of things that we can make change around. It doesn't have to be necessarily on Facebook or some big party or whatever, because like I said, once election time comes around, everybody is the hype. But once, let's just say 6 months from now, just because we, you know, whatever, however things have shaped up in the elections and things like that, there's still work to be done in between the every 4 years. So what does that look like for an artist, an educator, you know, all the different people who are on the ground that this impacts? So thank you for that. Because like you said, everything happens for a reason, whether or not we like it or not.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's really, you know, stay on message. You know what I mean? If that's what you about, then you need to be about it. And, you know, people know who, well, I'm not going to say people know who the real and the fake is, because I think that level of discernment is probably headed out the window, because so much of life is lived kind of artificially. But I can't really concern myself with that. At the end of the day, you know, I just try to live by a code, a no bullshit code. That's all. That's it. Just stand up. You know, if you see something wrong going on, if you can, if you feel like you can stand up and help make it right, do that. You know, if you're the type of person that don't like to stand up, do that too. But go in the back. Don't be up in the front. Go in the back where you belong. Just know where you're supposed to be. That's all.
That's it. Yeah, look at this.
Yeah,
well, I did want to give you some.
It ain't that big.
I do want to give you some time to actually share with people who are watching. And for those of you guys who got some questions for Jaytoo, definitely post. We're paying attention. How can people find out about, you know, your music? How can they find you online, your social media, and upcoming events? Can you share with us so that people who are interested, you know, can learn more about what you do?
No, I'm not online. I'm nowhere online. You can't find out anything about me. No, you can find me all over the internet at the DJ Yo Mama Love. That's T-H-E D-J-Y-O-M-A-M-A-L-U-V. So that covers multiple platforms, but, you know, just plug it in. You can check Instagram, Twitter, what's the other stuff? SoundCloud, MixCloud, Podomatic, YouTube. There's probably a couple more things. Twitch. So I'm all over that joint. I'm all over the place.
Actually,
and I mean, if you're looking on Facebook right now, you should be able to find me literally right now. If that's a concern.
DJ Djyomamaluv.
Yes.
So actually, it's so funny. I was thinking about that. As long as I've known you, I've never asked you this question. How did that name come about, if you don't mind sharing?
So it ain't nothing dirty. I mean, it would be nice if it would be nice if it was. I do like mamas, but I like aunties and, you know, all kind of all assortment. So, it was one of these things. So up until like the 2000, like early, like around 2000, I was still making mixtapes. And I still make tapes to this day. I still got tape decks in here and the whole thing. But what wound up happening, because I don't think, so the djyomamaluv is my tagline. Jaytoo is the actual work name, but the djyomamaluv is the tagline. And I would make the tapes. You know, I hit people off with them. You know, some time go by, maybe I see him, and you know, I ask him. I was like, "Yo, how was the tape?" Oh man, the tape was cool, but my mama took it from me, or it was like my auntie or my dad or somebody would always get them, but it would always be like an older relative. So, the light went off, and I don't know what made me put them three, you know, them four words together, but that was just how it formulated and it came out of my face. And I was like, oh, I got something here, because it got a flow and it's hella memorable. A lot of people will look at it a bunch of times and not really understand what they looking at. They see the words together, but they don't know, because it's all one word. So, and once they figure it out, they're like, oh, okay, all right, that's cute. So there it is. That's how that name was born.
And it's so funny because, you know, most people don't know, I tease him all the time, especially with our fellow brother Race, and he's always his bring all the ladies and the babies. So
yeah,
I'm always teasing you about the mamas and the aunties and the cousins and
I'm very shy. I'm very, very shy.
Yes. But I will say, you know, especially when speaking to your music, you definitely have a flavor that's all to your own and unique in that way, which I can appreciate. Definitely not someone that is, like I said, you know, plays all these, you know, like I said, and nothing wrong with that, you know, radio and popular songs or whatever, but you definitely dig in the crates.
I go a little deeper. I go a little deeper than normal, for sure.
Yes, you do. I'm like, man, where did he find that? And what's that? And, you know, all of that good stuff. Yeah. So
that's a whole episode.
How's your sketch coming along?
That's a whole episode by itself. So I'm just feeling... I'm doing some blocking out, and now I'm starting to put some of the black on, and I'm gonna have to probably hit it a couple of times with the black, and then I'm gonna have to get up and find this white, because I don't have nothing in the bag. Huh?
Can you show it again?
Can I show it again?
Okay. I want to see the finished product. So when you finish, you got to post it so we can see. I'm loving it.
Yeah, but, you know, I don't know if I'm going to be able to finish it all right now, but...
That's okay.
I'm the same way,
because right now, so it does take time for spray paint to dry. And so right now, I was managing to do both sides. But for the black, they're still drying. So for Marissa, if you're watching, I'm working on the red and the black. I still hadn't decided for Jamaica for the blue, which I think she wants probably a royal blue, but this is more of a navy blue. But I got the gold. So right now, I'm going to be working
on this. That don't look like navy. That looks more like royal blue to me.
It does. It's more of a navy blue. It's not really a royal blue. It works though.
Oh.
She's another female assistant that loves purple. So the final project will look like this. And I think both.
What color is that? Gold?
These are actually, I do have a gold set. So these are brown and like a rust color. Okay. But they will look like this. And actually, I did want to actually premiere a new product that I posted on my online store. I mentioned Creations by FN. So for those of you guys that are interested, and I've called it a rose gold purple rain, and it's kind of a tribute to Prince, but these are wooden pieces. One's a treble clef and one's a bass clef. The reason I know that is because I grew up playing classic piano, but I spray painted them like a rose gold to like a maroonish purple color. So I'm actually posting these for purchase online. And so if you're interested, hit me up. You can find me at Creations by FN on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, but also Freddie Niasha or Niasha. I have quite a few depending on what it is that you're looking for me for, but that's my creative space. So what'd you say?
I said,
Exactly. You know, multi-talents, you know, over the aquarium and me just, we have a lot of different things that we like to share with the world. What? But before we close Mr. J2, I just want to, you know, let you have the final floor on anything that you want to share with the world out there, the virtual world, anything about your art, upcoming projects, where to find you.
Nah, I mean, I always got something going on. I can't really even think about what it is right now. But I take that back. If you want some music, check out my podcast at Podomatic, SoundCloud, and MixCloud at the DJ JyomamaLuv. If you want to stay abreast of what's going on in my world, check me out on Twitter and Instagram, also at the DJ JyomamaLuv. Usually I post what's going on there. I think the next thing I have coming up is the quality control for Worldwide FM, Thursday, December 22nd. And I think that's from 2 to about 6. So I got about an hour and a half of me being fresh and styling on them, and they'll be going out worldwide. I'm all over the place though. I really am. So that's it.
And what about the New Year thing you said? I know it's not gonna be live, but you're gonna post it. What is it again?
So I'm not really sure. I'm waiting to hear back from the people. I just agreed to do it yesterday. So I'm waiting on the rest of the details. But that will be through, I used to DJ at a place called The Whistler. And I had a residency there for about almost seven years, which was also terminated due to Rona. So the Whistler, and they have a sister club called Sleeping Village, and it'll be through those guys that I actually, they'll be handling like hosting and running the whole thing. I just got to make it, send it in, but you will have to pay in order to hear it. So, yeah, I mean, that's what it is. That's where we are now. I'm like PBS. So it's an all day pledge drive all the time. Yeah.
Well, thank you for that. I'm actually going, if I can, you know, we have some technical issues, I'm going to try and close us out with a little bit of music by you.
What did you pick? I'm curious to see what you've discovered.
Can you hear anything? Are you able to hear anything?
I can't.
Nope. Let me try this, because
okay.
If I can get this I can get a little snippet, a little sample of people to actually share. He's so tickled by that, but you know, he's got a whole SoundCloud full of different mixes and things that I love.
It's more
Sunday set for the night.
Yeah, it's more stuff on MixCloud, but that was a segment from it was another residency I had for about 7 years, actually, or maybe five, but it was a long time. And we used to do it on Sunday afternoons. So it was I could get real fly and sexy on them in there. It was perfect. And you could be home by 10 o'clock and have had a full day on a Sunday. It was awesome.
This hour definitely was a full, nice, lovely hour on a Sunday full of music, laughs, creativity, your art, all of this. So thank you so very much. Again, you guys can find Jaytoo at the DJ Your Mama Love on a variety of different platforms. Thank you so much for joining me. Hope you guys have a blessed Sunday and an amazing week.